Welcome to day 9 of our Enchanted Princess Norway and Iceland vlog series. In this episode, we experience our first ever tender port. We explore the Icelandic town of Ísafjörður independently and encounter some absolutely magnificent scenes. Find out why we were completely shocked by what was in this building. And stay tuned until the end to find out why neither of us want to go to the Princess Theatre.
Hi, I'm Tom.
And I'm Dom.
And we are
Tom and Dom Travel.
Welcome to day 9, Ísafjörður.
This morning we got up quite early because we had our first tender experience coming up. But first of all, we had to head for breakfast. For breakfast this morning, I had hash browns, bacon and beans.
And I got to try, because, you know, in the buffet for breakfast, they've got so many different choices and selections from yogurt to cereals. Mm. But this morning, they had biscuits and gravy.
Yeah.
And obviously I've seen it on the telly. I've never ever got to try it out in real life. So this morning I tried some biscuits and gravy. And I got to say, they weren't as bad as they looked. They're like breaded scones with like a white sauce. It wasn't sweet. It wasn't savoury. It was quite strange. So yeah, I had a few bites out of it. I don't think it was my sort of cup of tea. I don't think I'd have it again, but it was quite a good little experience and something I'd never tried before.
Yeah, so it was okay. Okay, so straight after breakfast, we headed to get our tender.
So as Ísafjörður, thank you, is a tender port, what Princess had decided to do was issue tickets. Now, this was our first tender experience, so we had no idea or clue as to what to expect. But essentially, they said anybody that wanted to go ashore into town had to go to the piazza and pick up a tender ticket. And tenders were coming and going, and they'd just call out your ticket when there was enough space. We'd heard some horror stories in terms of the amount of time that we'd have to wait. But we were pleasantly surprised. There was a fair few people sat waiting, but we didn't have to wait longer than 20 minutes.
No, we picked up our ticket in the piazza and we sat in the salty dog grill and waited for our number to be called.
We'd both like to take the opportunity just to thank everybody in the land of YouTube and you for watching, subscribing and liking. We really, really do appreciate it. If you haven't done so already, just hit that subscribe button. If you like the content we're producing, press that like button. It really, really does help us out.
Yes, and we've got lots of cruises coming up, so keep an eye out on our channel for lots more content. Once our number was called, we headed down to deck 4 and boarded our first tender, which we were quite pleased about. We sat on the top deck, so a tender has a closed bottom deck and an open top deck. We sat on the open top deck and we are glad we did, because as we sailed away from Enchanted Princess, we had some spectacular views of the ship and it meant we could get some great footage.
Yeah, it was truly spectacular. As it was our first tender experience, we didn't really know what to expect. We sort of rushed on, went straight to the top and just sort of sat down. Mm. Obviously, in Iceland in June, August, it wasn't the warmest of days, but it was spectacular, really.
It was worth doing.
Yeah, definitely. The tender was full.
Yeah, and it took us about 20 minutes to get to land from the ship. When we arrived on the tender, we were quick to disembark. It was quite an orderly process, but we managed it. And we were greeted by a small area at the port that had what could only be described as like huts, maybe. So the tourist information was a small hut. There was a little local shop that was a small hut. And that was about it.
Yeah, it was quite a unique experience, really. I think this was the smallest port destination that we'd ever been to.
Yeah.
And yeah, we were really surprised, because essentially they were just a couple of huts at the port to sort of welcome you. They provided us with maps and sort of souvenirs and tourists.
Everybody was really friendly. All the locals were friendly, as they are across the whole of Iceland. Yeah. Really.
We were just really surprised at just how small the town was. We picked up a map from the tourist information hut and basically just followed the main road into Ísafjörður, and it was absolutely spectacular. There's like, I don't know how to describe it really, but there's like a lake or a really calm bit of water in the middle of Ísafjörður, with houses and Icelandic businesses either side.
Is it a lake or is it just...
I don't think it's a lake.
I think it's where the fjord comes around into a harbour, I think.
Yeah, it's like a harbour, but it's absolutely beautiful. Yeah. And we were just so lucky and fortunate to be there when we were, because obviously the glacial ice was still melting, so you could still see that. It was just really, really beautiful.
It felt peaceful as well, didn't it? So in the town itself, there was a few industrial buildings around as you first got into the town, but then it opened up into a nice little traditional Icelandic town, and we kind of followed all our other fellow passengers into the town itself, and then had a wander around the outskirts of town, and then headed towards a hill, I suppose it was, wasn't it? A pathway up a hill that the other passengers were going towards as well.
Yeah, so as we were walking, the majority of Enchanted Princess passengers were all going towards one direction, and Tom and myself were like, where are they going?
Not the band.
And in Ísafjörður, they've recently built a viewpoint. So you have to sort of climb up the side of the fjord. It's not too much of a walk, but there are some steep sort of areas. But they've completely redeveloped it, so it is sort of like a really good viewpoint just to have a look over the entire town and the area.
Yeah, well, it's got a dual use. So the first use, I suppose, what it was actually intended for is to redirect the runoff from the snow melt away from the town. But it also provides a lovely viewing point as well across the town. So it was great to walk up there.
Yeah, and the views from the top were absolutely spectacular. We took the opportunity to take some photos and some video.
As we headed back down the hill, we then walked back through Ísafjörður town and spotted a large house in the centre of town that had a children's playground next door. But this house was a tourist attraction, and we discovered that it was Ísafjörður Culture House.
So we couldn't resist going in and having a look, and what we found surprised us both, actually. On the bottom floor was the town library.
Yeah, there were some locals there playing chess and things as well, weren't there?
So the bottom floor was town library, and the librarian, for some reason, was dressed up as a character from Harry Potter.
Yeah, and one of the rooms in the library was decorated in Harry Potter theme, so... It was more British than Icelandic theme, which was interesting, but great.
So that was on the bottom floor. The library was essentially on the bottom floor. And then as you made your way upstairs, it was like a museum of what the house used to
be used for.
Yeah. And one of the uses was it used to be the old hospital.
Yeah. So great to see that. A couple of exhibitions there about what... used to go on in the hospital beds, some old medicines and cabinets full of paraphernalia to do with hospitals, I suppose.
It was really interesting because obviously I hadn't been at a hospital for quite some years, so it was quite interesting just to see how they how medical science has evolved over the last 100 years. Well, that's what was more interesting. And then, as we got to the top floor, we encountered something that neither of us could have sort of imagined.
No, so it was a Rolling Stones exhibition. So
For some reason.
I don't think we ever discovered why it was there.
Well, you know, lots and lots of Rolling Stones paraphernalia, posters, T-shirts, literally anything you can imagine Rolling Stones related was in this exhibition.
Yeah.
The Rolling Stones had never performed in Iceland.
Not as far as we know.
No, but it was written on one of the
displays
in the museum, that the fact that Rolling Stones had never performed in Iceland, although Mick Jagger had gone to Reykjavik at some point. So it's just really sort of out of the ordinary and something quite bizarre that really sort of...
Yeah, and they asked us to sign the visitor's book to say we'd been to the Rolling Stones exhibition, so we did. So look out for that if you do visit it.
From the Culture House, we decided to walk in the opposite direction around town. So we just followed the shore. We got some photos and videos of Enchanted Princess docked in the distance, which was really nice. Very much a sort of industrial feel to the town. And then we made our way into the centre of town and found sort of the main shopping area. Now, there wasn't sort of, you know, loads and loads of high street shops. There were one or two sort of traditional Icelandic stores.
Yeah.
Nothing too major, nothing too sort of significant. Well, I wouldn't say not significant, but you wouldn't find any sort of large chains within the town. In the middle of the town centre, they'd had some type of rainbow flag painted over the floor, maybe for some type of pride celebration that they had or were having, I don't know. But it was just really, really interesting and very, very pretty.
Yeah, beautiful. And from there then we headed back along the outskirts of town, which was a sea defensive wall. There we spotted lots of little things, little stone ornaments on the rocks. There was a cat there sleeping at one point, and a couple of locals walking their dogs. So, but what we did get was some beautiful views over the fjord and of Enchanted Princess.
No, absolutely. By now, we'd spent a good 3-4 hours ashore, and we were a little bit worried about returning on the tender because passengers on board had basically sort of given us some real bad horror stories about long waits to get on a tender to get back to the ship. So we decided to make our way back to basically tender pickup location on the port. And we were pleasantly surprised. We got there and a tender came and we got on it.
Yeah, so no, it didn't waiting. Take us long at all, really. No. And then another 20 minutes and we were back on board Enchanted Princess.
And again, some absolutely spectacular views.
And once again, we sat on the top deck, didn't we? So we had the best view, I think.
In terms of our tender experience, though?
It does add... Well, as I said, 20 minutes each way, so the best part of an hour onto your day, really. So,
not the most comfortable seats.
No, not the most comfortable seats. So, we definitely prefer to be docked alongside port. But as our first experience goes, it wasn't a bad one. We were back on the ship quite early because we had been invited to afternoon tea in the Sky Suite.
Yes, we're both really, really excited. We've mentioned Sue and John in our previous videos, and they basically invited us for afternoon tea in their Sky Suite, and it gave us the opportunity to do a little Sky Suite tour. Obviously, we'll just talk about the Sky Suite. Absolutely incredible. Who knew that these types of suites existed? Bear in mind, myself and Tom, we've only been cruising for 18 months at this point. And absolute pure luxury. Two bedrooms, both with ensuite bathrooms. Beautiful.
Biggest balcony at sea.
Biggest balcony at sea that pretty much wraps round the side of the ship up on deck 18. With spectacular views when you're cruising the fjords.
Yeah.
Just incredible.
And we have to say a big thank you to April, who is the suite manager, because she organised all that afternoon tea for us. And set up the room so we could film as well. So a big thank you to April.
No, absolutely. And if you're interested and want to see how the other half live, I'll put a link to the Sky Suite in the description.
We had a fantastic selection at afternoon tea. We had sandwiches, scones, bottle of champagne, fresh strawberries, you name it, we had it. It was fantastic, wasn't it?
It was absolutely beautiful. And to have it up on deck 18 in the Sky Suite was just an amazing experience.
Wonderful
really.
Experience, yeah.
We would have had it out on the balcony.
Yeah.
But it was just a little bit nippy, a little bit cold, so we decided to have it indoors. But it didn't sort of ruin the experience at all. We both had an incredible time. And once again, thank you, Sue and John.
Yes, thank you very much for inviting us.
We had an amazing afternoon in the Sky Suite with Sue and John, an afternoon tea. We stayed there for a little while, just chatting and talking. Yeah. And then we started, we made our way back to our cabin to basically get ready for the evening.
Once we were ready for dinner, we headed out and straight to the Amalfi restaurant.
Yes, for our usual reservation at 7 o'clock. And yeah. Once again, absolutely no queuing. We got the opportunity just to walk straight through and got a table without any bother at all.
No problems.
In the main dining room this evening, it was Italian night, which meant special bread. if you'd seen any of our previous vlogs, you know that, you know, I myself in particular, I really do love a fresh bread, especially the ones they make on cruise ships. I don't know, I just find it really, really tasty. And tonight there was a selection of Italian breads, which were absolutely delicious.
Lovely, lovely. So for starters then, not just talking about bread, I had the soup to start once again. Minestrone soup, as it was Italian night, and it was delicious.
And for my starter, I didn't actually pick anything from the starter menu. I really, really wanted the spaghetti and meatballs. I'm a big pasta lover. So I had a little portion of spaghetti and meatballs and it was beautiful. The pasta on board is absolutely incredible.
It is nice, isn't it?
If we haven't mentioned it before, it's all freshly made on board and it is beautiful.
Fantastic. So for main then, I had the lasagna, which was a wild mushroom lasagna. However, for me, they packed a lot of spinach into it, so it wasn't my favourite thing to have. It could have done with less spinach and it would have been fine.
And for my main, I had the breaded chicken with, I think it was like a Prosecco cream sauce. It was absolutely beautiful. Really, really tasty. It was really quite rich. Yeah. I would definitely have it again because it was beautiful. For dessert then, yeah, we both decided to have the trio of Italian desserts.
Well, you couldn't not really on Italian night, so why not?
And included in that was a little pot of tiramisu, mm-hmm, which was absolutely beautiful.
Lovely.
I really do like tiramisu. Some cookies, some authentic Italian biscuits, and a gelato sandwich, which was really, really good.
Lovely.
As well.
Really nice.
Proper gelato, and it basically ended the meal beautifully. The food in the main dining room for Italian night, we both thoroughly enjoyed, and a definite big thumbs up from both of us. Well done, Princess. After our main dining room experience, then we made our way to take five.
Yes, yeah, so we thought we'd try mixing up our routine tonight. So we headed to Take Five and thought, let's try a couple of their cocktails, which we did. Their cocktails were absolutely fantastic, actually. If you get to try cocktails in Take Five, it's a completely different menu, all based on around the jazz theme, which Take Five is based on. And we probably got through quite a few cocktails, didn't we?
We did. So we pretty much started. We didn't get through every single one of them because some of them,
no.
Like the Bourbon one that I tried on Sky Princess, I didn't have that one again because I knew I didn't like it. But essentially, we just went through the drinks menu and just picked ones that we thought we would like. We even asked the waiters, and they are waiters, servers. They are really, really knowledgeable.
Yeah.
If you sort of engage with them, tell them what you like, what you don't like, they can come up with suggestions. And they're really, really helpful.
Yeah, and they did give us a few good recommendations, didn't they?
They did.
We really enjoyed the cocktails there.
As well as the ambience.
The ambience is great. Obviously, there's a jazz band playing in Take Five. which gave us a different feel for the evening. So we decided to stay in Type 5 rather than go to the theatre, which we'd done every night so far with the cruise. So we switched it up a little bit, had more of a chilled night because we were quite tired from walking around the whole day. Well, the whole couple of weeks so far in our cruise. So we took it a little bit slowly and thought we'll do a cocktail night instead.
Yes, whether or not it went slowly from there onwards.
No, that was our thinking at the time.
Yeah, that was our thinking at the time. So Take 5 is, as Tom said, a lovely little jazz bar that is tucked away just at the side of the casino. You can get in there from deck 6 off the main piazza or from the deck 6 entrance to the Princess Theatre.
Yes, don't be put off by the double doors because it is double doors to get into there, which means it's one of the only places that's actually not open to the piazza.
Yeah. And we've always found there's plenty of seats available. It's really big space, so it does sort of, they don't sort of cram you in there. It is a very relaxed sort of feel. We were trying to decide whether or not to go to the main theatre, but as we previously mentioned, they've actually recycled the entertainment. So the majority of acts in our first week were doing additional shows at the beginning of our second week, which this was. So even though it was a different show, we decided just to stay in Take 5 and soak up the ambience. While we were in Take 5, what I did notice was the gin trolley. Now, basically, there was a selection of gins on there and they would wheel the trolley to your table and make you a gin cocktail, a gin-based drink of your choosing from the menu. However, there was an additional charge of $16 for that experience. The many times and while we were in Take 5, we didn't see anybody use it at all.
No. So,
but just interesting.
It if is you there are, if you want it.
Yeah, if you are a gin lover, they've got this little trolley that you can request.
Take 5 was great, and we had, as we said, a few cocktails in there. But what we did then, we headed over to Crooners for some more live music, as there is a piano in Crooners Bar that plays live music later on in the evening. So they do class that on Princess as a late night venue. Finishes about 12:30 in Crooners. We got Crooners is always busy though, so much busier than Take 5 was. But we did manage to get a seat at the back.
Yeah, right at the back. Pretty much when we got there, it was the only table that was free. So we sort of sat ourselves down and then started to make our way through Crooner's drink menu. Please don't judge us. We were on holiday.
It wasn't that many. But what we did, we sat down on a table that probably accommodates 5 to 6 passengers. So a couple of other passengers came to sit with us and then we got talking and we had a couple of drinks. So
yeah, really, really good night.
Really good night. Lovely to speak to all our fellow passengers. Yeah. Great to meet more people on board.
Well, it's one of the joys of cruising, isn't it? The fact that you get to meet so many interesting people.
Yeah.
The table that we were sat at in Crooners was right by the window. Yeah. And we were both really, really sort of surprised that it was sort of 11, 12 o'clock. And we looked out the window and we couldn't believe just how light it was
outside. Still daylight.
It was pretty much. It was just a real surreal experience considering it's sort of we'd been out and it was quite late.
Yeah.
And just how light it was outside. So we took the opportunity to take some photos and just basically enjoy the experience.
Yeah, it's great being in that part of the world where so much of the day is daylight and it's such a different experience to see a sunset, basically early morning sunset, really. It was a fantastic experience.
So after a very sort of cocktail orientated evening,
you keep going on about these cocktails.
We basically made our way back to our cabin and straight to bed. We didn't even have any food.
No food. Sleep because we're up early again tomorrow because we're heading to
Grundarsfjörður.
In his best Icelandic accent.
Thank you. So it is another tender port.
So another tender experience. So we will let you know how that goes.
Fantastic. Thanks for watching our day 9 vlog of our Norway and Iceland Enchanted Princess cruise. If you've got any comments, just pop them in the box below and we'll get back to you.
And please don't forget to like and subscribe. Thanks for watching. Bye.
Thanks for watching. Please like and subscribe and don't forget to check us out on social media.